Well, as usual, Deidre was too generous, but I appreciate her kind introduction and for the work she put in producing today's workshop, but really for the work she's done for many, many years on this set of important issues. She's a dear friend, and it's really great to come out here and see you. So thank you for doing that. And obviously, for decades, Berkeley has been at the forefront of public debates about freedom of speech, freedom of association, civil rights. So it's probably appropriate, I think it's appropriate, that our third workshop on big data and privacy is happening here. The discussions we've heard today built on and deepened some themes that have come up throughout this review of big data and privacy, particularly in our previous workshops that we did at MIT and NYU. So I want to thank all of the panelists. They were just exceptional for their thoughtfulness and for their expertise. And of course, I want to thank all of you for joining us here today. I think to the people who work for the federal government, my job tonight is to say, go back to work. There are many of you here, so it was good to hear that list. I should probably just quote Mitchell Stevens and say that our report should first and primarily be a normative discussion of this basket of issues, and then just go sit down. But I think you, I think we probably owe you a little bit of our reflections as we plow into the time of actually writing this report. The technologies, of course, and applications we've heard about today in our previous workshops may be new, but the legal and policy questions that these technologies raise are quite old. Big data requires us to ask ourselves, how do we embrace new technologies and the progress they bring to our society while at the same time protecting our fundamental freedoms and values like privacy, fairness, and self-determination? It's been referenced that I was one of the staff authors of the Electronic Communications Privacy Act. I was working for then a young senator, Pat Leahy, in 1984. And it might be worth just spending a second talking about how we began the journey to write the Electronic Communications Privacy Act. We actually sent a letter to the Attorney General asking whether the existing wiretap statute, which was passed in 1968, most of you who are lawyers will know it as T3, Title III of the Omnibus Crime Control and Safe Streets Act, applied to electronic communications. Fairly simple and straightforward question. Did the Wiretap Act apply to email and other forms of electronic communications? Months later, we heard back from his deputy, who told us that the answer to our question was neither clear nor obvious. So that reply didn't inspire confidence in the team that was working on this. So for the next 2 years, Senator Leahy, along with his House colleagues, Don Edwards, who's from this area, and Bob Kastenmeier, worked to update the law for modern times. The result, as was noted, was the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, which with some updates, and I will note with a few more needed, still govern internet communications today. It wasn't that we were just moronic back in 1986. We were faced with a series of precedents about how third parties handled data that were daunting in terms of trying to provide protection for electronic communication. So this was indeed a negotiated compromise. On the other side of the table was Ed Meese and Ronald Reagan. I think that this really was perhaps a unique law in that we took a problem before anyone knew that its full dimensions and really legislated in a forward-looking manner. And obviously today we're engaged in the administration to try to think about how we correct the deficiencies, particularly the one that was mentioned here today about the difference between 180 days and 181 days of storage and others. And we're engaging again with my old boss on this topic. So a few years after that, I knew Lee would be here. Deirdre mentioned forming CDT. I also hosted a organizing meeting for a new group dedicated to civil liberties. And somehow I dug out my Electronic Frontier Foundation card that says member number 33. So Lee Tien and EFF are still fighting to find the balance between civil rights, personal freedom, and technological advancement. And of course, I've become the man. So it's a long, strange journey. What can I tell you? But we all know that rapid change is the one constant in technology. And in the information age, those changes come at an incredible rate. In 1998, when Google was first getting its start, less than 5% of the world was online. Today, 3/4 of the people in developed countries and 4 in 10 people worldwide have internet access. As Americans, our willingness to innovate, to experiment, to build new things, to try new ideas has built the largest and strongest economy in the world. But from a centralized postal service at the founding of our country all the way through Snapchat, each technological advance has prompted serious debate about its implications for other values that we hold dear, like equality, privacy, and personal freedom. We're about two-thirds, or maybe even a little more, through our study of big data and privacy. Since President Obama asked me to lead this review back in January, working with our colleagues, the head of the Office of Science and Technology Policy, John Holdren, the Secretary of Commerce, Penny Pritzker, the Secretary of Energy, Ernie Moniz, and our National Economic Advisor, Jeff Zients. We've met with privacy advocates and technology companies, with academic researchers and advertisers, with law enforcement agencies and civil rights groups. We're receiving public input through a request for information. That comment process was due to close yesterday, but we extended it to accept submissions through the end of this week. We've also asked for feedback from the public through a survey on the White House website. You can find that at whitehouse.gov/bigdata, and I encourage you to fill it out, pass it along to your network of friends. We're really interested in the results. So far, we've gotten really tens of thousands of answers to that survey, and we're looking forward to providing a public review of that when we issue our report. The 90-day review is fundamentally a scoping exercise, not a policy development process. But after today, I'm making one exception. Listening to Ken Bamberger, we're changing our policy to ensure that Google glasses being used in the White House gym have not been hacked. So really, we hope to raise the relevant questions we must ask now and in the future. We've been casting, as you can tell, a wide net as we ask how big data technologies have begun to transform government, commerce, and society, and as we examine the potential implications for our social and civic values. The President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology, often referred to as PCAST, is working in parallel on a report that's taking an even deeper dive into the technologies themselves, from machine learning and algorithms to sensor technology and new models for data storage. And that will be released around the same time that our report comes out. Both our study and PCAST's work also aim to look ahead as much as that's possible, given how rapidly technology changes, and to anticipate what today's trends might look like for our lives, our economy, and our world in decades to come. Without getting too far over my skis about what will be in the report that we haven't written yet, I want to share with you some observations about what we've learned during this process of consultation. But first, I want to say a few words, because I think it's important in this audience, about our ongoing effort inside the administration to reform how we collect information to keep our country safe. I should be clear, specific intelligence programs are not a part of the study of big data that I am leading, but are central to the debate in which we find ourselves. Last week, as you have all seen, I think, the President announced a plan to significantly change the way the Section 215 telephone metadata program works. As you know, the program has been subject to a great deal of controversy in recent months as we, as a nation, debated our signals intelligence practices, and really as the whole world has debated that. Under the President's proposal, the government will not collect or hold metadata in bulk. Instead, those records will remain with telephone companies and will be available to intelligence agencies only under court order. We're working with Congress to put this plan into law, and we're continuing a wide range of efforts to improve transparency and oversight of our intelligence program. The President asked us to conduct this study, I think, because he recognized, even as the administration took steps to review and reform intelligence practices, the intelligence community is only a part of the picture when it comes to big data. These technologies touch every sector of the economy, from government to industry to research, and will only continue to grow in importance. That was made clear today. I want to say up front that we recognize big data technologies can create significant economic value and are spurring tremendous real innovation. From the very beginning, the Obama administration has worked to make more public data available through our Open Data Initiative. Danny worked on that during his tenure in government. Entrepreneurs and developers have used these data to create countless applications, build successful businesses. We've also known for a long time that the information age requires us to carefully consider how we protect personal data. That's why, as been mentioned, and particularly in the last panel, in 2012, the president released a consumer privacy blueprint and the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights, which sets out principles that aim to protect user privacy without restricting the innovation potential of the internet. So in the midst of what some are calling a big data revolution, we're taking this opportunity to consider the landscape and to really interrogate whether our existing policies are prepared for what's on the horizon technologically. Throughout this process, we've asked three questions. First, what is new and different about big data technology and techniques compared to traditional data analysis? Second, what questions should we be asking about big data's relationship to privacy and other rights and values? That we began with the first panel on that question specifically, and it's been a theme throughout the day. And finally, do our existing policies, and in particular, the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights, provide an adequate policy framework for the era of big data, or are there gaps where new policy or new research needs to be developed? Of course, we first had to decide on a definition of big data, something that probably could have taken those of us who are working on it the entire 90 days of our review to settle on. But for the purposes of our study, we've been thinking of big data as data sets that are so large in volume, so diverse in variety, and changing with such velocity that traditional modes of data analysis are insufficient. I think there are a few technological trends that bear being drawn out that we have really focused on. First is and again, many of these things have been mentioned today, but I just want to tell you how we're approaching this. First, on the technology side, the declining cost of collection, storage, and processing of data combined with new sources of data like sensors, cameras, and other observational technologies, particularly geospatial technologies, means that we live in a world of near ubiquitous data collection. That question was raised on the last panel. Can we control that? Can we move it? I think the way at least I'm thinking about it is we live in a world of ubiquitous data collection. And as more companies produce web-enabled appliances, wearable technologies, advanced sensors to monitor everything from health indicators to energy use to my running speed, the Internet of Things will add huge amounts of new data to what is commonly collected today. Data analysis is also being conducted at a speed that is increasingly approaching real time, with a growing potential to have an immediate effect on our environment or decisions being made about our lives. Second, one of the most powerful things about big data analysis is what is sometimes referred to as data fusion. By combining multiple sources and types of data, big data can lead to some remarkable insights. But it can also lead to what our friends in the intelligence community maybe call the so-called mosaic effect, whereby personal information can be derived or inferred from data sets that did not include personal identified information. Third, the information revealed by big data analysis isn't necessarily perfect. Identifying a pattern doesn't establish whether the pattern's significant. Correlation still doesn't necessarily equal causation. So as these technologies become more prevalent, we'll need to be deliberate in developing strong scientific standards and strong ethical standards for judging the results of big data analysis and predictive algorithms, as was raised on again throughout the day. Finally, there are some promising, I think, technological means to better protect privacy in a big data world. That came up particularly at MIT. Encrypting data, perturbing data so it is no longer represents real individuals, or giving users more say over how their data is used through personal profiles or controls are among the technological solutions that are being researched and implemented today. But none of them are perfect, and technology alone cannot protect privacy absent strong social norms and a responsive policy and legal framework. So I want to share a few examples of what it means in the real world. You heard them particularly in the afternoon panel. The United States spends more on healthcare per capita with worse outcomes than any other developed country. As a consequence, healthcare costs are a major driver of our federal deficit. It's urgently important that we find ways to bring down costs while improving health outcomes. That was what a good chunk of the ACA was all about. And big data is showing us how to do that. We heard some examples in the panel this afternoon, but I'll give you just a couple others. One study synthesized millions of data samples from monitors in a neonatal intensive care unit to try and pinpoint which babies were likely to contract potentially fatal infections. By analyzing all that data, not just what the doctors noted on their rounds, the project was able to identify factors like increases in heart rate that serve as early warning signs that that an infection may be taking root. And those early signs of infection are not something even an experienced or an attentive doctor might catch through traditional practices. In another instance, by crunching huge amounts of data from electronic medical records, researchers determined the characteristics that increase or decrease the likelihood that a patient will be readmitted to a hospital after receiving treatment. We've had real success in the early implementation of the ACA through Medicare in reducing the number of readmissions already by pinpointing what works, what doesn't, and changing the compensation model for how hospitals are paid for whether they keep people from being readmitted or not. So those are a couple of examples of big data techniques that are leading to advances in patient care. But data mining also poses privacy concerns, especially in the healthcare context. Our medical history is amongst our most sensitive personal information. LaTanya Sweeney, who many of you know, a Harvard researcher who is currently the chief technology officer at the FTC, has repeatedly demonstrated that it's possible to use publicly available data, to identify individual patients in supposedly de-identified medical data sets. Think again, this point. You made this point earlier this afternoon. In other contexts, there are big data sets that pose no or really remote risks, and we have to, I think, be aware of that to personal privacy. One example is public data on climate, weather, and environmental factors. I just got a note on my BlackBerry that the House of Representatives, in its forward-leaning effort to work from the Science Committee, just passed a bill saying that the Weather Service should only work on weather and not on climate. But I don't think that has a lot of chance in the Senate, fear not. The amount of information publicly available from huge networks of sensors in a fleet of NOAA and NASA satellites these days has fueled our understanding of how climate is changing. Those data get plugged into complex computer models. They predict sea level rise, ocean acidification, the heat of fire, storm surge risk, and other climate impacts. We just released at climate.data.gov more than 100 sets of very important data that private sector can use to provide apps to local communities and businesses to reduce the risk of climate impacts coming forward, particularly with respect to sea level rise. But we have more coming on health and other aspects of our changing environment as a result of climate change. At the same time, I think even civic-minded big data applications can have implications for personal privacy, including for equality and for non-discrimination. And I think we're thinking a lot about that in our study. Let me give you one example. In Boston, the city released an app called Street Bump that used smartphone sensors to detect potholes and report them to the Department of Public Works. But what happened after Street Bump was first rolled out in Boston should give us, I think, a little bit of pause, because poor people and the elderly were less likely to carry smartphones, let alone download the app. The app wound up systematically directing city services to wealthier neighborhoods. Now, to its credit, the city of Boston figured that out, and they tweaked the app to take into account under reporting so that everyone would have equal access to city services. But the lesson is that we have to pay careful attention to unexpected outcomes of the use of that the use of big data might lead to, and how to remedy unintended discrimination or inequality that may result. As I said earlier, this review is a scoping exercise aimed at identifying trends and defining the questions that will inform future research and policy development. But a few big issues, I think, are coming into focus. I'd like to just touch on a few of those before I conclude. I think they were reinforced throughout the day. First, I believe that the notice and consent framework that has governed data collection for decades, going back to particularly to the 1970s, is coming under great stress in the big data context. In public spaces, people are often unaware of the degree in which sensors, cameras, other data collection tools are recording information about them. They may not fully understand how the information gets used or shared. And if people aren't reading terms of use agreements on their computers before they click OK, it seems unlikely that they're going to parse pages of legalese that may accompany their smart watch, their Nike Fuel Band. I thought we should let Fitbit off the hook, at least late in the day, or other wearable devices. So there's an active and ongoing debate about how we can shore up the notice and consent framework that has been the bedrock of consumer privacy for four decades, or whether we need to create other ways to ensure people's personal information or information collected about them is being responsibly used in a big data world. There was some dispute about which way to lean on that question in our last panel. Next, it's also clear that what constitutes responsible use will be different in different contexts. That's why I think the Privacy Bill of Rights and the blueprint were so focused on context as an important driver. Companies and researchers working with sensitive medical or financial information may have different responsibilities, quite frankly, than marketers looking to connect you with online advertisements that match what they predict you might want to buy. In particular, I think, as the president said in January, the United States government must hold itself to a higher standard when it comes to using data responsibly. He was speaking of how we handle data in the intelligence context, but protecting sensitive data is a challenge that many federal agencies have taken seriously for decades. Some were mentioned, Census Bureau, IRS, HHS, many others. Defining responsible use standards for federal agencies is essential for public trust and will need to be balanced against the economic benefits of opening more government data. With big data, the government can lead by example in other ways as well. For instance, by making it easier for people to access data that the government holds about them. The Department of Veteran Affairs Blue Button tool helps veterans access medical records, manage their health care, and correct any errors in their files, all in one easily accessible place. The My Data initiative at the Department of Education seeks to give every student access to his or her academic data so they can make more informed decisions about college choices and study needs. Efforts like these encourage greater transparency in how data are collected and used. They give people more control over their personal information. I think they provide, an example for the private sector. The flow of big data is, of course, global in scale. And recognizing that, the president charged us to consider how we can forge international norms on how to manage this data so to inform the process, we've met with a range of foreign counterparts, including privacy regulators from across Europe and the Americas. That's why it was so important that Rainer Stenzel made the trek here to be with us today. Thank you for doing that. There is a tremendous interest in how big data challenges existing regulatory and ethical paradigms for privacy. There are clearly no simple answers, but it's clear that there's a whole lot riding on getting the answers at least in the right zone, including the future of a single, open, interoperable, secure, and reliable global internet, and the free flow of information that comes from that. Big data raises real policy questions for governments around the world, but I would note that even the European regulators we met with, Rainer, you might fight me on this, but they said that the conversation here in the U.S. is as deep and more technologically informed as anywhere in the world. It's clear from the conversations amongst all the panels today, the policy implications are serious. One of the issues that has emerged powerfully today is the need to have a really serious conversation about civil rights and discrimination in the big data context. Big data analysis of information voluntarily shared on social networks has showed how easy it can be to infer information about race, ethnicity, religion, gender, age, and sexual orientation, amongst other personal details. We've got a strong legal framework in this country forbidding discrimination based on these criteria in a variety of contexts, but it's easy to imagine how big data technologies, if used to cross legal lines, we have been careful to set in those contexts, could end up reinforcing existing inequities in housing and credit, in employment and health and employment. This is a place where Cynthia Dwork's question on the last panel about how to think about the relationship between utility and fairness, I think, comes into highest relief. All this leads, I think, to a few important technical conclusions about the world of big data in which we increasingly live. First, that the costs and physical footprint of recording data about this world is shrinking to zero. So our expectation of actions being recorded will only increase. Second, the streams of information that might fall into the category of surveillance are rapidly increasing in number and diversity and being put to some interesting uses. Behind all the powerful functionality in our smartphones or our cars are sensors for temperature, audio, acceleration, light, heat that are more sensitive than anything that was available to consumers 3 decades ago when the FIPS were created. Third, as the opportunities for big data analytics increase, so will the demand for high-performance computing capable of supporting it. The architecture for high-performance computing to do computational simulation of complex systems is merging with the architectures of big data analysis. That will have important implications for energy, to manufacturing, to research and development. And finally, it's clear that the paradigm in big data will be defined by the move from search to prediction, or maybe better said, from predicated search to a non-predicated search, raising a whole number of practical and ethical questions for consumers, for companies, particularly for governments and for law enforcement. For those of you looking for what we think the most important social and ethical questions these trends raise, stay tuned. The report will come out in a matter of weeks. So with those insights in mind, let me just end with this note. Melvin Kranzberg's 6 laws of technology begin by stating technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. Like Kranzberg, I believe technological progress demands that we engage with the social, ethical, legal, and political questions that arise. So I want to thank you again for your time and your thoughtful engagement during today's workshop and throughout our review of big data and privacy. I'm confident that this is a conversation that will continue inside the administration, but more importantly, in every corner of our country and around the globe. After today, we'll be returning to Washington, all these people who came out here, to draft and review our report. We look forward to releasing our findings in the very near term. I want to thank you for your attention. I think the hour is late. Deidre, if you want me to take a couple questions, I'm happy to do it. But if you want to, all right, I'm happy to do it. Great.
Hi, I'm going to ask you the question that I wanted to ask the last panel, but I'd kind of like to hear from you as well.
They probably would have had a better answer.
So it feels like it's a bit of a failure of imagination. When covering the dichotomy in the last panel, they kept focusing on use or consent or, you know, this sort of, you know, it's one or the other. I think the real dichotomy is that's the false dichotomy is between either we regulate a lot or we fear regulation, and we have a market that just runs amok, collecting and using and doing whatever it wants. And I get that the market, that right now we haven't developed markets that will essentially pay for the creation of privacy-focused technologies, or we haven't developed that very well. But to me, one of the purposes of the government is not just to incentivize. Like, there was a guy up on an earlier panel who talked about taxing the movement of data each time it's used. I don't think that's really possible. How are we going to do that? But I do think that it's possible for the government to step in and incentivize in other ways. And so my question is, why isn't the U.S. government considering essentially underwriting some development, acting as a venture capitalist? And I would ask you to not say, oh, well, we're doing that with NSTIC, because NSTIC is focusing specifically on identity technology. I want to know why we're not supporting the development of personal data control and privacy technologies so that we can have those out in the marketplace and we don't necessarily have to regulate everything. Maybe we just regulate around the edges.
That's a great question. And I think that the government does have a role in investment in cutting edge technology, not just in the application side, but in the privacy enhancement side. The NSF is spending about $200 million a year. That's probably inadequate. I think that's one of the things that we want to consider, and I mentioned it in my remarks. That come back to Mitchell's point. That I think there are things that we can do beyond just scoping where policy needs to be developed. First, to have a normative discussion about what we ought to expect from the public sector, from the private sector, from, quite frankly, from the academic research center sector. We can also, I think, enhance and invest in technologies that protect privacy. And I think we're doing some of that. I think, you know, my guess is we'll consider whether we think we should be doing more of that. But I don't think that's not a total answer. And again, I tried to comment on that as well, that I think that there's no perfect technological solution to the range of issues about personal integrity that arise from the use of analytics, particularly these predictive analytics. So I think we're going to have to find our way through. I see you still have your hand up. So.
I'm asking about venture capital that goes to little startups that can really innovate.
We've had our successes and our failures with venture capital in the energy sector in particular. And it's tough, I have to say. You know, the most successful venture capitalists in technology development space have probably been the CIA and DARPA. Because no one questions their failures, so in putting that money out the door, I think in this regard the NSF grants are smaller grants and are basically going mostly to academic researchers and maybe exclusively to academic researchers. But it is a challenge to put venture money out the door, as we learned in the energy technology. We've had tremendous success with that loan program, but you're criticized for every failure, where a venture capital approach anticipates, you know, I'm out here in the land of venture capitalists, so you tell me how many misses you get for every one good hit. That's very hard for the government to do.
I would encourage you, as you start putting together the report, to think about competition and the potential unintended consequences that picking a particular privacy regime could have in picking winners and losers in the competitive realm. It's more of a comment. I don't know if I need a response.
A point well taken. We'll take that. You know, we had a chance to talk a little bit earlier, so I know where you're coming from, and we'll at least kick that around with our crowd.
Hi, welcome to the Bay Area, and I'm from Oakland, and you're probably aware of the resistance of the local population to federal funding of domestic surveillance, and I'm just wondering to what extent local engagement with cities and states on their policy formulation on privacy and because you're already spending a fortune on, as a government, on privacy management, just from the other end of data collection. What extent did you engaging with cities and states on this?
We have engaged with, that's a very good question. I think we have engaged in the arenas of people who are collecting and using big data for municipal management. But you're raising a different set of questions. And we've talked to local law enforcement also about their data practices. And some of those are controversial in terms of particularly crime reduction and profiling and surveillance in that context. But you're asking at a higher level, can the U.S. government have influence over what the data collection practices and uses are at the local level? That tends to end up being, that in itself has a kind of sectoral flavor to it, so that the education department is dealing extensively with the way school districts handle manage data, and the data practices underneath them. The health sector similarly, as I said, our focus has really been on municipal management, the use of big data to manage big problems like transportation, energy reduction, crime reduction, where there's a lot of promise and people are, you can go across the country and you agree or disagree with their particular application, but cities like Chicago, New York, and others have made tremendous use of big data tools in order to produce better results. I mentioned the pothole question in Boston.
Oh, is that me? Sorry. I appreciated your comment earlier about discrimination, fairness, and disparate impact. And we've heard a lot sort of from agencies who are working on the consumer protection. And I wonder to what extent you feel like there might be space for agencies that have offices of civil rights, for instance, Education Department, to be involved in these conversations or in the study, if that's been part of the outreach.
Well, we've obviously, because we met together, we've reached out to the civil rights community extensively. And with respect, I think that with respect to the agencies represented, there has been participation at that level. I think one of the things that is maybe a likely result is to kind of will be to try to look to agencies about their own data practices and think about them from that perspective. And I think, so this will not be the end of the story. I think this will kick off work that has to be done at tailored at the individual agency level. So I think it will certainly, particularly if as I suspect, we lift up this question about the potential for discrimination, I think there'll be a lot of follow-on work to be done.
So the point has been made that no single privacy technology can really give us everything that we want. And in fact, no combination of privacy technologies can really give us anything that we want. That sort of overly accurate answers to too many questions is fundamentally in conflict with privacy of any kind. So we have to get to the point of considering denial. When do we... How can law and policy start to impose limits on the use of information when we know that fundamentally there is, you can't have it all?
Well, again, I think Julie went through this. There are policy regimes that we've taken on board at a sectoral level which absolutely do that through proscribing activity in the fair credit space or in other spaces, proscribe activity that's made illegal by the formulation of those statutes. The question is, can you come up with general rules that really perform that function? That's, I think, a more difficult question when you get out of a sectoral approach. And that's why having a normative framework is important. And I think it's why the question that I think was pinpointed here, which is, what's if there is harm, how do you address that harm, is something that I think that that could be, I think, formulated in a more non-sectoral, more generic approach. Again, I think that's what the Privacy Bill of Rights attempted to do. And I think what big data does is, and the change is the thing I mentioned at the end, that movement from predicated searches to non-predicated searches, not just in the public sector, but to kind of begin to tease out from the data itself predictions about people, about behavior, et cetera. That's, I think, that's challenging, and Kama reassured us that the framework settles that. I'm still trying to think that one through. All right.